the topic today, democratic institutions for tomorrow. And in the context of this year's Innocracy theme, how do we master transformation? Our focus in terms of institutions and will be mainly focusing on the big ones, the obvious ones, the constitution, parliament, government, parties, elections. Just some small topics. and for these small topics, we have little time, around 45 minutes, but maybe it's as precious as in real life. Thank you all for being here. Thank you all for being here. I'm really honored to be with you and share one podcast with you. I'd like to introduce you very briefly. Next to me is Claudia Chwalisch. She's a political analyst based in Paris, but originally Canadian. She's a book author and part of the OECD's Open Government Unit. There's Regula Stempfli, a political philosopher based in Munich, but born in Switzerland. She has the post of the Hannah Arendt Lecture at the University of St. Gallen. She's the founder of the European Citizens Initiative and a successful book author. Her recent book is called Trumpism, and I would say go for it. And Uffe Elbeck, a political entrepreneur, member of parliament, based in Copenhagen, as he is Danish and in Danish parliament. He was a former minister of culture and is the founder of the party Die Alternative, and also founder of the alternative business school Chaos Pilots. My name is Milo Tessela. I'm a political entrepreneur and strategic advisor based in Vienna and co-founder director of Democracy 21. I'd like to start with a short short view on the status quo of our institutions. Let's not get too deep into it because we all know the problems, but you have very precise individual perspectives and experiences in that sense. And globalization, digitalization, climate crisis, we do live in a very complex world, and nobody's easy with the fact that there is no simple answer, and not even one answer. So I'd like to know your very personal, individual view on how are our institutions doing, Regula?
Well, since I wrote Trumpism, a phenomenon is conquering the world, it's framing and hurting our democracies. And I'm trying to pinpoint that to the big distance between narratives, fiction, and coding. So everything that is the kind of meta level and everything that we believe or believe to be true and the reality politics, you know. And so for me, the democracy at the moment is in such a bad state is because we don't have the room for public space and the in-between anymore to give the reality, the real terms of living for people also enough weight into the political discourse. So this, there was always a distance. I mean, I'm not the one who says, oh no, you know, in olden times even the future was better. But what I'm saying is that what has happened the last 20 and 30 years, I would pinpoint it to 1999, where it got really clear, is that that difference between the codes, the ideology, the rapport, the news speak, that has a certain language, technocratic language and so on, of the so-called elite, which is sometimes powerless as well, but the distance between that, which is kind of the ruling worldview, and the reality that we experience with our bodies, with our feelings, with everything, there is a huge difference. So it's a kind of a loss of the real world that we are actually witnessing and experiencing. And what we don't do, and that's why I come to the transformation, what we don't do is to totally rethink that mechanism of coding the world, having ideologies that rule implicitly or directly or structurally, and the real world as we are experiencing it. You know, even today we are such in a rot of using words that are such. That are so technocratic, that are so far from what we are actually were invited to talk today. So we're already in that spinning. So that's one of the most important things that I would like to get across, is this loss of reality of the world and the in-between that we could establish amongst ourselves in a public space, and the deconstruction of elitist bank speak talk, or you know, coding talk, or looking at ideology as if it was a force de la nature, as if it was not to be designed. I hope I made myself clear. I'm going to come to concrete examples because that's where I'm working on. Where does it happen and why does it happen? So, and overall, I think democracies are still the best systems to live in, I have to tell you. Otherwise, I wouldn't be sitting here.
Claudia, would you like to go on as a more closer one to actual institutions, consulting them and so on?
Yeah, I mean, in some ways, I agree with Regula. I think that, I mean, for those who came to the Inspire talk that I gave earlier, I was talking about how our time today has been characterized in some ways by the three P's of polarization, populism, and pessimism, and how, you know, as you were saying just now, it's not that there was ever some sort of golden age, but there is something that is inherently different about what we're experiencing today. And this context usually has three sets of explanations or three lenses through which we see it, one being the economic, so this notion of a left behind, I say that in quotes, which is usually the term talked about, but of having a sense that inequality has spiraled out of control, that there are some voices which are no longer heard and people are disempowered. There's a second lens, which is through talking about cultural anxieties and differences which have been provoked in many cases by immigration. And I think there's a lot of truth in both of those theories, that since globalization, there has been a sort of divergence of values. So I'm not sure if this is what you were referring to in some ways, this notion of the elites versus the rest, but a lot of work by the scholars Engelhardt and Velzel, for instance, looking at the World Value Survey, which is an international survey that has been done since the 1980s, so we have comparable data from then until now, has shown that overall, as a whole, societies have moved away from more traditional values like religion and authority and so on, towards a majority having more liberal, secular values, more tolerant, and today's elite tends to be represented by those values, but that doesn't mean that everybody in society has come to embrace them, and this is where we see some of the tensions around cultural issues coming to a head today, because our elected representatives tend to be part of the overarching worldview, which the World Value Survey shows as a whole the majority has headed in that direction, but that doesn't mean everybody has and there's anything inherently right about it either. But then there's a third lens which is about the political, and this touches on the fact that trust today, both in government by citizens, but also of government in citizens and people between one another, is also at a historic low. So again, there was no golden age, but when you look at surveys that were done in the 1950s compared to today, there is a marked decline in trust. There's an increase in people feeling like politicians are just in it for themselves. There's a sense that, I mean, I know some of the statistics from the UK, from the Hansard Society survey, which is done annually, for instance, that there's an increase of people people feeling like the democratic system is just not working anymore. And more, and today more than ever, there's people are wanting to have more of a direct say in being able to shape the decisions that are affecting their lives, which is also different to the past, that desire to want to more actively shape those processes and decisions.
Thank you. Uffe, as a practitioner?
I think we are all practitioners.
Yeah.
What was the question?
The question is, what's the state of our institutions?
Yeah,
so
I know what the question was, but it
I thought you were
going to say. Do I want to answer that?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. answer whatever you want.
I think that I could answer on very, very different levels, because if you look into the Danish-Scandinavian situation, is that you see a decline in trust between the public and the elected politician, mainly on national level, not so much on city level. But if Danes should rate who do they respect, then the politicians are getting really, really low, actually lowest of the low. I only think that the used car sellers are more trustful than
used car
sellers
or lawyers.
But there are three professions who are in the same pool of distrust, and that's used car sellers, politicians, and journalists. So we can see that really, and it's just going down and down and down. Even if we are a country where you have high rate when it comes to people going to election participation in elections, etc. So in a way, we have still a very solid democratic system in Scandinavia and also in North Europe. So, but we can see the same patterns showing up. And if I should say some more dark as an answer, I think that we see right now in Europe that a growing environment for really right-wing, radical right-wing parties, fascist-like parties, and because all the elements are there in place right now, you see people's insecurity and fear about do I have a role in the future? There's really this feeling that people are losing territory when it comes to identity, home, profession, etc. A bit like what you said, Claudia. Mm. And there are political forces who use that kind of insecurity among people, broadly said. There's this feeling that they highlight the past as the golden age. Everything was better in the past. And then they introduce an enemy picture, somebody who destroy this past where everything was okay. Then they start to question democratic institutions. They make a difference between the people and the elite. They criticize the mainstream serious media, etc., etc. We see the same picture happening in the U.S. as we see in Europe. And if you look through a lot of the last elections globally, you see right-wing profiles voted in. You see it in Trump in U.S. You see it in Brazil. You see it in Hungary. You see it in Poland. We have the whole Brexit issue in UK. And if you listen to some of the right-wing movers and shakers, like Brennan, for example, he goes out and say, well, our mission is to destroy the society as we know it today so we can rebuild and build a new society. So if you ask me about what is the state of our institutions, I'm really worried. And I have to say that we are in a situation where we both have to protect our democratic institutions at the same time we change it. And that's a very interesting dilemma. How do you really stand up for the mainstream serious media and at the same time change it? How do you stand up for the parliament structure and change it?
I think that's a, if I may, that's a, it's a very good point. And look at what's happening with the digital revolution. Yeah. I do not, I mean, there, my answer would be strengthen the existing democracies, but also kind of welcoming the transition in the digital age. Yeah. And my argument there is no taxation or no data without representation. If you remember, the American Revolution started with no taxation without representation. So no taxes without my political or a community political saying in it. And I don't, yeah. you know, for example, it's very easy to say exactly the same thing, that no data without political representation. And I'm saying also, yeah. all human beings, since the codes are what define us, or the framing, like my wrong framing that I have in this today, or whatever. So if we're saying that we're a code, so I say all human beings have the right to count same. You know, so I mean, there are so many tools in our constitutions that just need translation, and they need much more, not just intellectuals, but politicians, yeah. movers, shakers, women, to actually make the democracy that is there, the constitution, alive again. Yeah. And what I don't understand is why, I mean, you know, I've been saying this, and since I was in Brussels, I'm not just nobody, but I've been saying this for 10 years. I don't understand why a lot of NGOs don't take up very simple measures, like no data without representation. All human beings have the right to count the same. Human labor is much more, counts much more than data labor. You know, we do the contrary. We pay data mining, big data. We pay that a million times more than a nurse looking after elderly people. I mean, that's radical thinking in a sense of you take the existing constitutions and bring them to life. And I know that I hurt some of you guys who work for NGOs, because you actually profit from a system which is very technocratic, because you need to get money that you can do at least a little bit in the field. But I urge you, honestly, I mean, cut the crap with all the rating systems, the technocratical, bureaucratic formulas, and try to adapt a radical thinking if you really want to do the democracy. One point to you about Engelhardt, you know, I mean, Engelhardt, Claudia, sorry, Engelhardt, and then I stop, but I really think, you know, move. We have a day under the theme of transition and democracy. And I just, this is the 150th conference, and if it's technocratic, I use my will and my freedom that I can express what I think. So Engelhardt has, he calls the values, the democratic values, postmodern. You know, it's the post-materialistic values. There, I could talk a lot about it. You know, that these I'm are sure. the progressive values and so on.
I didn't frame it in that way. It's
no,
just to say that
because of the trust, you yeah. say the trust in democracies yeah. have disappeared. And I'm saying, well, yes, and rightly so. Rightly so. Yeah. The yeah. situations of a lot of people have really worsened the last 20 years.
Yeah. Oh, but I completely agree. That's why I was saying that there are these three lenses which, you know, you can't just talk about the economy or just the cultural changes or just the trust, that they're all intertwined. And sometimes we focus too much just on one of those explanations or theories of change. And it's only more recently, I think, when we talk about populism, for instance, or the rise of the far right, that these questions about democracy and trust and disillusionment with the system of governance have actually come into these discussions. For a long time, they were really dominated by the economic and the cultural theories. But my point of bringing about, although the three lenses too, is that I don't think it's just by different economic policies or different policies on immigration that we're going to solve the issues. It's more fundamental than that, and I completely agree with
you. But
you
can change the life.
But it's also about more fundamental changes to the democratic system. But how do you do it in such a way that you don't tear it apart, but that you can build and enhance the representative democracy that we have today?
You mentioned the people that don't trust journalists and don't trust politicians as like the least group of professions. So there is no trust in politics. People don't trust each other. There was a statement today in the morning saying that we maybe have to admit that we are powerless. And the way I observe it, citizens feel they are powerless. And the funny thing is, politicians as well feel that they are powerless, because I don't know any parliamentarian who feels that he or she has slight power of anything. So it's basically the more complex it is, the powerless everyone involved feels. So my question is, if we start from scratch, or if we allow us to think from a blank paper, how would we design democracy from scratch? We agreed democracy might be the form of most liberty and peace. Would we have still a parliament? Would we still elect? Would we still held elections? Would we have ministries? Or just an example from Austria, we organize our educational policies based on the K&K monarchy mindset. So how do we set up, if we allow us to build it from scratch? Any ideas?
I have some, but before, but before,
I'm sure. I give it back to you.
Yeah, I know. I like you.
I give it back to you. Yeah, go ahead.
But before I answer that specific question, I just want to add to the other dilemma we talked about, because one thing is that there's a growing distrust between public and elected politician, as a Grand Canyon big distrust many places. The problem is that this is happening at the same time as you see that many at least national elected politicians looks a lot like each other, because if you have, and again I'm speaking from a Scandinavian point of view, you have different political parties from left to right, but if you look into the way we elect candidates running for parliament elections, first of all, there's only 4% of the population who is member of a political party. So actually, if we talk about democracy, you could say, what do we do about the 96% of the population? Because only 4% is member of a political party. And these 4% is the people who elect candidates for running for election. And so what you see is that first of all, it's a very small amount of the population who are able to elect candidates, and the candidates start to look alike cross party lines, because they have gone through the same party structures and have the same kind of academic background, and they are part of the same kind of cultural and social sphere. So over time you see this growing distrust, and then you see the potential of what you, I would call, a political class. And that is a portion to democracy as we know it today. So I would maybe reframe the question, say, how do we go from a 4% democracy to a 96% democracy? And then back to your question, at the last election, my party decided to run for the Prime Minister's office, which was crazy, of course, because we were such a small new party. But we had this feeling that we had to change this US-alike democratic election in Denmark, where you had two blocks and you had two prime minister candidates. So we said there should at least be a third, and we wanted others come on the stage so we could have more prime minister candidates. But because we did that, we also had to think, if I was sitting in the prime minister's office after the election day, how should I govern the parliament? So we actually created a government program, and we totally redesigned all the ministries and the dynamics, and we proposed that we should not, we have a one chamber system in Denmark, and we said we should have at least a second chamber, a citizens chamber, where for a period of 3 months, people like a people's lottery, we could select a group of citizens who for 3 months could work full-time as we did as MPs and discuss very important issues which they thought was important. And we, on the other hand, in the first chamber, could ask questions to the citizens' chambers to reflect the lawmaking on the floor. So we had all kinds of interesting ideas. And for me, it was inspiring to get this assignment saying, how would we organize a country, a nation? So it was a super interesting task. So I can just recommend, try to do it.
Yeah, I think that's a brilliant idea to have a group of people and, you know, taking the best out of democratic elements. I mean, I would certainly take federalism.
Yeah.
I really like, you know, federalism, local politics, yeah, and having a strong hold there. So I like the ideas of two chambers. Yeah. I mean, everything has ups and downs. And I also would suggest, for example, keep the constitutions, but I would definitely reduce the years of member of parliament, to 12 or 16 years.
I would say eight.
That's a bit short, but it doesn't matter. But you know that. But I love the citizen participation, and that day, I think it's a brilliant idea to scratch.
And just to add on it. We looked into the constitution and said when we looked into the constitution, it's very difficult to change the constitution for obvious reason. But what we recommended was that, for example, nature should have rights in the new constitution. That so you can't attack or misuse nature, yes, then you, yes, are able to go to law, to the court, yeah, and run cases in the court on behalf of nature. And this is sounds, first time you hear it, it sounds crazy, but actually you have constitutions around the world where you have given nature rights. For example, Ganges, the river in India, has constitutional rights or legal rights. Mm-hmm. You have the
there's
same.
There's a river in New Zealand as well.
In New Zealand, you have it. You have it in the U.S.
As well.
And I think that's an extremely important step to take to give nature rights in the constitution. So again, it's just to broaden up our imagination about how would we really like the society look like, which voices would we like to invite to the table. Which perspectives would we like to invite to the table? And how could it, yeah?
Claudia, any ideas?
Yeah, no, I mean, it's one of those questions I've thought a lot about, and I'm personally not convinced that if we had to start from scratch today, electoral democracy would even be at the center of what we consider democracy. It's become so intertwined, these two concepts, but it's only as of the last 200 or 300 years that's been the case. And for centuries before that, democracy had nothing to do with elections. And this principle of a random selection, of having lotteries and people deliberating, and the principle of rotation, that it's not like you're randomly selected and you do it for a long, long time, but maybe for 3 months, maybe for 6 months, or for, you have a civic duty to also be part of those decisions that are being taken collectively for your society. And you know that, okay, after a while, it's other people like you who have to play just as active a role, because I'm not sure a functioning democracy would require everybody to be constantly, permanently, super engaged all the time. That's almost a sign that something is wrong. So thinking about how we take collective decisions today from a blank page, I don't know if elections come into it. I mean, I'm not saying we should scrap them, because I'm still speaking in the capacity of my OECD affiliation. Yeah. So, just to clarify, that's not an official OECD recommendation in any way.
I'm not very happy with it at all. I think there's some interesting examples actually today
where we see some innovations to enhance representative democracy in ways that bring in this notion of sortition or random selection. So for instance, in the German-speaking region of Belgium, the parliament there voted this past February unanimously to institute a new citizens' council. And this is 24 randomly selected citizens who have an agenda-setting mandate. So they are the ones who will decide what are the 1, 2, 3 issues every single year which will go to citizens' assemblies. And each of these citizens' assemblies is also a randomly selected deliberative body. Each of them has 25 to 50 people who meet at least 3 times over 3 months, and it can be more depending on the issue. And their role is to give recommendations to Parliament. And now there's new legislation which says that the Parliament must have at least 2 debates about those recommendations, and there's an onus on the government to respond. So it's an interesting way that we're seeing actually
but that's not democratizing the elections, that's democratizing the committee system. You know, the normal expert committee meetings. And I think that's a very good idea. It's not democratizing.
But it's like a second chamber, though. It's not a committee. It has a different role.
Yeah, but then I would design the second chamber differently. But we don't need to talk about the institutions as long as we can agree on certain principles. And I definitely say we have a lot of elements in our existing constitutions. The Swiss constitution is actually very good because it's one of the newest one of 1999, and the right to nature, you know, that by the rule of law, the perpetrator, you know, whoever hurts nature or has to prove that they take care of the environment and all living beings and humans, and not that we have to prove in a court of law that our rights are being hurt. You know, that's the same what I would suggest against Google, Amazon, Facebook and Apple, to say it's absolutely ridiculous that I have to prove, you know, my right, which has been violated for the last 15 years, my right of privacy and how we deal with the data. So, I mean, the ingredients are there. They need to be translated. And the democratization of expert committees, hearing committees, I mean, that's very important. And there the lottery could come in. Otherwise, the lottery, like even as you described it, it sounds very much like a new coding. And you know, whoever makes the code makes the cliches. You know, I mean, code is nothing but cliches in algorithms.
I don't really get what you're saying.
So when you write a code, you know, you have certain logic that you apply to. And for example, when you use any browsers, but especially Google autocomplete, you get an autocomplete full of cliches. Google woman, you know, and what do you get suggested as an algorithm, you know, as hits, and it's very cliched. I mean, this is a very strongly ongoing debate about the bias, the algorithmic. It's called algorithmic bias.
I don't really see the link to your point about random selection.
The way you define random selection is also a certain pattern of what you understand to be politics. You know, I'm not sure whether that system is not getting close to the identity between the ruled and the rulers. And that's a very right-wing and fascist concept, a totalitarian concept. If you want the governed and the governors to be identical, that is very totalitarian.
But it's almost the opposite point in the sense that, I mean, what we were just talking about, that the governed all seem to resemble one another. So the idea of
that
having a random selection is to bring in the perspectives and voices of the groups of people who are not as active and participating. I mean, there's quite a lot of research which shows that even in other forms of participation, like political participation, which are bottom-up or open, there's a disproportionate level of participation by certain demographics, which tend to be male, older, well-off, well-educated, more urban. So how do we try to overcome this challenge? And I think that trying to reincarnate sortition, which is the technical term for random selection, the modern age, is quite an interesting approach to that. And in many cases, it's taken the form of what's called a civic lottery, which has two stages. The first, where there's a really large number of invitations that go out at completely at random, so usually 10 to 20,000 invitations, which go from the mayor or the minister or whoever's initiating a process.
How are these invitations going out? They're going out
by the post.
By the post, yeah. So. Yeah. When do you get an invitation?
I just finish explaining the concept, please?
Yeah. So there's a first.
I'm not saying it's perfect. Yeah. I'm just trying to explain what the notion is.
I would take it just as one idea of several that we can't discuss too much in detail, as we are also running out of time.
Yeah. I was trying to bring in the notion that it also, because it brings in the different perspectives, just having the cognitive diversity is also beneficial in itself to leading to better decisions. And there's quite a lot of research also from different fields, from psychology and business as well, which support that same theory. So there's the democratic arguments, but there's also arguments about just having better decisions that are taken, more effectiveness.
If we speak on about how to transform, if we speak of maybe a democracy of the 100 rather than the 4 and the 96, but I get your point. What are our levers to from powerlessness to from the feeling of powerlessness to empower ourselves? What do you suggest are our spaces of maneuvering to maybe change something in between, regarding sortition? What's your levers in Denmark to?
I think that we have to broaden our view a bit about democratization, because it's not only a question about how does the parliament works. It's also about how does the democratic decision process works in our schools, in our kindergartens, in our local communities, at our educational institutions, in our workplaces. So we have really to discuss about how do we actually organize ourselves, and who decides what, and who has a voice and who has not a voice in a specific decision moments. And if I could just say it should be like, I think it should be, I would really like to see a new democratic movement where we really are talking about democratization in our workplaces, in our companies, that the staff should at least have 50% of the seats in the boards of all companies, etc., etc. I would actually like to go to a more radical approach and say you can't talk about political democracy without talking about economic democracy, because economic democracy, who has the money has also the power. And that is more extreme. For example, if you are running for president in the U.S., you can only do it if you're backed up by the most profiled and wealthy companies and institutions. It's not a democracy in my understanding of democracy. So what I really like is what is happening. Yesterday, I walked through the city of Berlin, and Extinction Rebellion was occupying a bridge just in the neighborhood, and it was, for me, it was nice. It was so nice. No, but it was super nice, goddammit. It was people who were saying we're taking back the public space. We have to react on our knowledge and put it into action. That's the reason why I think a lot of the feeling of zombiness or that we're sleeping is a way to, in a way, to accept that we know what is wrong, but we don't act on it. It's a super complex situation, psychological situation we are all in right now, that we know everything now, but we don't act on it. And what kind of emotional system are we building up internally when it's like we don't want to look at it, and we just want to be like Matrix, like the movie Matrix, that we don't look at it. I want to take my democracy authority back and raise my voice. In the situation, I have to raise my voice, even if it's in parliament where I have access, but also in my local community and the board meetings and whatever. So it's democracy is so much more than parliament.
Yeah, reclaim public space.
Yeah,
I absolutely agree. I think that's, and to actually realize again how much public space we have lost, and how to reclaim the public space also in a different way to dare more democracy in all kind of fields.
A very very banal but concrete example is at the moment in Copenhagen. Nice city. Anyway,
Copenhagen.
Joking. I love Berlin. Yeah. I have to say that. Anyway, but what is happening in Copenhagen right now in the public space is interesting for me at least. More than 50% of the citizens go on bike every morning. Just take it in. More than 50% of the citizens go on bike every morning. So. We have a public space called a road.
Yes.
The road is divided into where the cars can drive and where the bicycles can drive. In Copenhagen, we are quite good at the bicycling lanes. But because of the amount of people going on bikes, we're closing into a critical tipping point where the bicycling people start to think, why on earth are we pushed into a small bicycle lane where we are more than 50% are going by bike, and then you look and see the cars driving by
with one person.
So people are starting to say, this is unacceptable. And they start to say, you could drive on the bicycling line, and we are going out. Yeah. So we are closing into something where it turns 180 degree of how to understand what is fair and what is not fair. And that is what, beside in my dark moments, I'm thinking about fascism. Then in the light moments, I'm thinking about exactly. We are taking back democracy.
Thank you. Good.
Claudia, one last remark in terms of...
We can, if you wanted to move on to our next question, we...
No, we'll finish.
All right, okay. No, because I very much agree basically with what everything before was saying, and part of the work that I'm doing at the OECD about citizen participation, it's not just about the institutions, it's a lot broader than that, and thinking about new ways of thinking about public goods, so like public space, public services, data as a public good is part of that actually, and also this idea of democratic fitness, which refers to, I don't know if anyone here knows Peter McLeod from SLBP in Canada, so that's a phrase that I sort of stole from him and I give him credit for.
He's a smart guy.
Yeah, he's brilliant. But this idea of democratic fitness, meaning having citizens who have agency, meaning they feel they can actually affect change around them, who have opportunities to flex their civic muscles, because democracy is a practice. It's not something that just the parliament does. It's a habit, it's a culture. And it needs to be practiced in order for it to be sustained. So I think all the examples that you're picking up on are also things that completely, I think, are part of the bigger picture. And we can't just talk about institutions, because if the democratic culture isn't strong enough, that's when we take those institutions for granted.
Regula Stempfli.
Wake up, wake up.
Uffe Elbeck, Claudia Chvalis. Thank you very much for this teaser on the institutions for tomorrow.